Well, welcome. Welcome to another episode of the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. I'm Dr. Naftali Serrano, and today we're going to be working on the middle section of a typical consult called the functional analysis. But before we start that, I just want to apologize to my podcast listeners for taking a while in getting to this next podcast. Life gets busy. My life includes a two-year-old whom I primarily watch over while my wife finishes her medical training, so we've been caught up in quite a few things. In addition, still working on arranging some of those interviews. Tough because other people are busy as well, and so we're just trying to get everything together. But it looks pretty good for mid-July to get at least one interview done. I'd like to get two interviews done perhaps in July with some of the key leaders in behavioral health in the country. So that's coming up, so thanks for hanging in there. And again, the purpose of this podcast really is to fill a void for the many people around the country who really don't have any real access to any sort of training related to behavioral health consultation, working with primary care physicians in a clinic real-time in this model. It is a very, very new thing, and I find it quite exciting. I work at a couple of clinics, one in Madison, Wisconsin, and I actually work via internet video conferencing with another clinic in Chicago, a clinic that I've worked at now for several years. So it's really fun stuff. I love it, and my goal is to help other people get excited about it as well, as unexciting as these podcasts might be. So, in any case, we're going to be talking about the functional analysis. We'll just spend a couple of minutes today on it, and in our next few podcasts should be a little bit more entertaining phone interviews with some of these folks. Well, we started the last time with the introduction, so if you haven't listened to that podcast, it might make sense for you to back up and listen to that one first. Although you can probably track fairly well either way. Once you get done with the introduction and you transition to what's called the functional analysis, what you're really looking to do is do an assessment of the patient, but not in the traditional kind of 50-minute hour clinical interview that you're taught in graduate school. That obviously is way too long for a primary care setting, and also quite impractical. One of the things that particularly is an issue for serving minorities and providing a good match in terms of services for minorities is this whole issue of how much assessment we typically put in as psychologists when we see a patient initially. You know, that first session, we kind of just take it to make a differential diagnosis. And while that might be helpful to us, it's not very helpful to the patient coming in who really wants some sense of direction and some sense of what they can do about the issue right then and there. And so particularly for minority groups, and I'm talking here about Asians, African Americans, and Hispanics, the set of expectations they often come in with are, I'm going to be helped right away. There's something that I'm going to walk away with. And that's one of the problems of doing a traditional long assessment. So the functional analysis kind of turns assessment on its head. It's not assessment for assessment's sake. It's assessment that also serves as intervention all at once. And the goals of this kind of assessment are different than the traditional goals in very important ways that we're going to discuss. Let's start with just what are those main goals of a good functional analysis. Well, the main goals typically include assessing the nature, severity, and duration of the problem. So you ask questions like, how long has it been since you've been having these sleep issues? How long has it been since you've been feeling down? How long has it been since you've had these somatic sensations in different parts of your body? And how difficult has it been? How much has it impacted your life, your work, your relationships? And so that's not too different from a traditional assessment. What is that you're automatically also then going to be asking questions about the patient's response to the stressor. their coping efforts, in essence. You want to get a sense of how are they responding to life and the things that life throws at them. For example, lots of patients will actually stop their normal coping efforts when they encounter these kind of stresses in their life. So instead of continuing to do things that are enjoyable or fun for them to do during the course of a problem, during the course of a stressor, whether it be a relationship problem, a work stressor, or some other type of physical issue, they will often get sidetracked from their normal coping efforts and stop doing things like meeting with their friends or taking walks or exercising, eating well. And this obviously diminishes the patient's ability to actually cope with the stressor. Often people will begin doing a lot of problem-solving coping, depending upon their typical coping patterns. But they'll start focusing on the problem and trying to solve it. And if it's a chronic-type problem, say a chronic disease, that approach doesn't work very well over the long term, because if you stop coping in order to focus on the problem and solve it, but it's a chronic problem, obviously the problem is of a long-term duration. Eventually you're going to wear yourself down by not engaging these coping, your normal coping efforts, and even trying to enhance those coping efforts. So you're going to ask some questions during the functional analysis that will assess how they're responding. Questions such as, so what have you tried to do so far to make things better or to help yourself through this situation? Those kind of questions will get at the patient's response to the stressor. You're also in a good functional analysis looking at assessing moderating variables that affect the problem. And I find questions about their daily life very helpful in this way. And again, this relates to their coping efforts, where I'm asking questions related to things that make things better or might make things worse. So, for example, I'll ask a great question often, which is, tell me what a typical day looks like for you. What time do you wake up? Do you eat breakfast? Give me details so that I get a flavor for how you're living life right now. And the patient will start describing their day, and usually they'll start elicit information. They'll give information related to whether they're socially isolated, whether they're physically active, whether they're working a great deal, perhaps more than they should, whether they're avoiding certain situations or engaging others, whether their life has a sort of balance to it. And so those moderating variables are very important in terms of functionally assessing how the person's doing with life, how they're functioning. And by virtue of assessing that, you also start looking at and determining some links to what actually can be done to change perhaps some of their habits and some of their kind of daily routine. So you assess those moderating variables affecting the problem. Finally, one of the other things that you're looking to do in a good functional analysis is really determining the most likely area that can be easily modified within the next few days or week in order to promote change and begin to kind of get a person unstuck from their situation. And this is where you transition from the functional analysis to the problem-solving section that we'll talk more in the next session. But the trick is that when you do a good functional assessment, a great functional assessment will actually lead very, very easily and naturally into a good problem-solving section of the consult. It'll even often be quite obvious to the patient what really needs to change or what area they can begin to work on immediately. A good example of this is there have been times when, I'm talking with particularly Mexican immigrant patients, and one of the characteristics that Mexican immigrant patients share is that they work extremely hard. Sometimes the men are here apart from their families for long periods of time. Sometimes they're here with their families working a day job and a night job, essentially working anywhere from 60 to 80 hours easily, and often working 7 days a week. And as we begin to talk, and their primary concern might be some depressive symptoms, often it's lots of physical type of complaints, and we'll talk, and I'll ask them about their daily life, and I'll ask them what they do and what kind of things they're engaged in. Do they go to church? Do they spend time with friends? Do they do any of these kind of things? And as I'm asking the questions, they are becoming aware of the things that are missing in their life that would help them to cope with the strain and stress that they're enduring. And often by the time I get to the problem-solving section, it's very easy to then kind of transition by saying, you know, it really seems to me that you are an incredibly responsible, hard worker. But even the most responsible, hard worker needs some balance in their life. And it sounds like there's not a lot of time for you to engage other things in your life, like friendships, like spending time with your family, or even just being by yourself sometimes. And by that point, the person has already kind of come to that conclusion through the nature of my questions, and is kind of ready to say, yes, that's true. And then we, in the problem-solving section, will look at what keeps them from perhaps creating a better balance, and what can we do to make that balance work for them. So these are the main goals of a functional analysis. And again, the trick is to really, as you're asking the questions, you're doing the intervention as well, because you, by asking those type of questions, you are leading the patient to begin to think about coping, and coping effectively as the way to begin to get unstuck and start dealing with their issues in a more functional way. So let me run through a few questions that I will typically ask during a functional analysis. And, you know, each situation is going to be quite different, so which questions I ask will depend on the situation. But this is a list of questions that I would typically ask. So tell me hour by hour what a typical day is like for you. That is a classic question, and that elicits so much information in a short period of time. You're really getting a sense of really how a person is responding to life, and that is really crucial to getting a sense of how adaptive their coping is. Another question is, what have you tried thus far to deal or cope with this problem, like we talked about before? How are they literally responding? Many people will say, I'm not sure, I've tried anything, or if it's a relationship, I've tried talking it out, or things like that. And sometimes it's important to actually elicit a little bit more by giving examples, like saying, do you ever take walks when you're upset? Do you ever call up a friend? Do you ever exercise? Questions like that to get them thinking and understanding what coping actually is. And that will elicit further information about things they've tried that have worked and other things that haven't worked as much. Another good question is, what kind of things typically are enjoyable for you, things you look forward to doing? And that's another great question that I use, because it catches people off guard. Most people, when they come, they're often so focused on their problems, so focused on the stressor, so focused on the physical symptom or the emotional consequences of the stressor they're going through, that they stop thinking about life in its kind of totality. And asking that question often elicits a very emotional response, usually a smile, sometimes bewilderment, sometimes like, boy, it's been so long since I've even tried to think about doing anything enjoyable. But it triggers that understanding that, oh, wow, it's been a long time since I went out to eat at a restaurant, or it's been a long time since I, you know, called up my friend, things like that. Another question is, who are the people that you feel know you and that you can count on? That's obviously a question looking at kind of engaging social support. What would it look like for you to be better? And try to be specific and behavioral about it. That's another kind of question that I ask as I try to lead a person to kind of get a sense of what they're hoping for. For example, particularly people who really are a little bit hard on themselves and have a hard time dealing with their weakness in the face, or quote-unquote weakness in the face of a difficult situation. And I will, ask them this question, and they'll typically say, well, I don't want to feel depressed anymore, or I want to stop crying. And it'll be an opportunity to actually turn it around on them as we enter kind of more of a problem-solving formation. Well, I'll say, you know, it's interesting to me because you're going through this very difficult time. You've lost your job. You're having, you know, some stress in your marriage. And yet you're asking yourself not to struggle. And I'll say, you know, those two things kind of seem incompatible to me, don't you think? It may just be that you're being a little hard on yourself, and maybe what you're feeling is actually quite a normal response. That's kind of taking a more of an acceptance approach. So, another good question. You know, certainly during a functional assessment, there's some really specific questions that are always important, things related to use of alcohol, use of drugs. Aside from that, I'll also ask questions related to their church attendance or other religious kind of involvement. Religious coping is probably one of the underutilized areas in mental health. And yet the reality is that aside from primary care, one of the top ways of dealing with mental health issues for the majority of folks in this country particularly is religious coping, whether it be individual personal prayer, whether it be using scriptures, using meditation, going to church, seeking the advice of a priest or a pastor. It is a huge, huge area. So I'm often assessing where an individual is coming from, what their religious background is, and whether that's an area that we can capitalize on. Finally, another question, and again, this is just a sample of questions, is which of these behaviors do you feel like you can most easily change or adjust? And so there I'm kind of trying to lead a person to understanding some of the basics of behavior change, which include change things that are most easily changeable first, and then move on to bigger things. And that's a huge credo with behavioral health consultation. You want positive yardage. You want to help a person really gain momentum and confidence in their ability to change so that they can then change the larger issues that they face. Well, that's what a good functional analysis entails. Now, it is an absolute challenge, even for the most experienced behavioral health consultant, to do a good functional analysis. And I can tell you that even now, after practicing probably 3 or 4 years in the model, there are still days where I walk out of a consult and I know that I've done a very poor job of really getting a sense of where the person is coming from. In fact, I'll give you a story about one of the first times that I was being trained. I was being trained at this time by Dr. Kirk Strosel, and he flies in, and of course he's shadowing me, and of course the first case I get is a bipolar substance abusing individual. The physician calls me into the room to work, and you know, I zoom in right away onto the bipolar disorder and the fact that she's not taking her medication, and I spend the rest of the session trying to communicate with her and really trying to get a sense of why she's not on the medication and what services she has, and spend the rest of the time making phone calls to see if we can get her in to see a psychiatrist. And all this time, Dr. Strozel is kind of sitting in the background, and after it's all done, he kind of looks at me and he says, "Do you even know who this person is? Do you have a sense for how she's responding to the mood swings? Do you have a sense for how she's coping with life?" And of course, I didn't. I had no sense of why. Why? Because I didn't take the time to do a really good functional analysis. I just kind of jumped to the traditional assumption that what you needed to do was be on medication. What you needed to do was be compliant with treatment. The reality is that that had not worked. It had not worked for many years for her to be compliant. And in fact, the default message that I was sending with my behavior was that medication was the only way in which she could really control or manage her life. And certainly, that was not true. It was just what I was focused on at the time. And what I realized was that it would have helped if I just kind of sat down and asked her about her life, asked her what she did on a normal day, what she does when she gets up in the morning, how she responds to relationship stress, how she responds to other stressors that may trigger her during the course of a day, how she responds to her mood states, how she might self-medicate some of those mood states, do some education in terms of things that she can do to manage her cyclical patterns, and do what I do now with lots of bipolar patients, which is teach them about riding the waves of their cyclical patterns. Now, of course, I still recommend medication and much more able to work with physicians now on that without having necessarily to refer out to psychiatrists. But the point is that functional analysis is what gives you the real flavor for the behavior, the context of the behavior of the individual, and the functional and maladaptive ways in which people respond to the kinds of stresses that they face in their life. And what I love about a good functional analysis is that while identifying and contextualizing the problem, the stressor, it also, when well done, empowers the patient to feel like, hey, I have a new way of looking at this problem. And it not only is it a new way, but it's a way that makes sense that I can actually do something with, because of the way that you begin to kind of operationally define what needs to be done. So it's no longer, oh, what needs to be done is I need to take this medication. And medication might be part of the change plan. But what needs to be done is, I need to be getting out of my house more frequently. Or I need to be taking more time for myself and setting some boundaries with my daughter who drops off her grandkids with me unexpectedly. It means, I think I just need to get out and do more fun things. I need to call my friends more frequently. I need to ask for help more frequently. Any number of kinds of things that functionally point a person to things they can do to begin to cope with their issues in a more functional and adaptive way. Now, lots of people are quite skeptical because they think, well, aren't you just offering kind of easy, simple solutions? And we'll talk about this more in the next podcast that'll deal with the last section of a consult, the problem formation section, or the problem solving section. But no, it because of the way in which you operationally define it through the situation, through the functional analysis. It's not saying, well, taking walks will solve your problems, or talking to friends will make your depression go away, or this is a quick fix for this. No, not at all. What it is it's actually the real impact, I think, is what it teaches the patient about the nature of the problem, and that oftentimes the nature of the problem is misunderstood by the individual. And therefore, they are doing things that are actually not helpful in terms of dealing with that particular type of problem. And so by changing their approach to that problem, even with small, seemingly insignificant things, the patient takes a whole new approach to that problem and is empowered to solve that problem. I'll give you a good example just from an encounter I had with a patient. This was a middle-aged, older middle-aged African-American female who presented with what were essentially anxiety symptoms, some palpitations, somatic complaints of different kinds that are classic, some muscle tension, some numbness and tingling down one arm, that kind of a thing. And as we're talking, I go through the functional analysis, and it becomes clear as I'm asking questions about her life and things that this person really doesn't do very much for herself. She's taking care of her grandchildren, for her daughter, and doesn't have a lot of time really for anything to do with things that she's interested in, or things for relaxation or other things. And, you know, once it got to kind of the end of the functional analysis, it was kind of clear to me. I asked, you know, what do you do for fun? And she kind of looked at me quizzically and was like, fun? I don't even remember the last time I had fun. I said, well, you know, that's kind of a problem, because, you know, in life you kind of have to keep at least these four areas in balance. And this is something I use a lot in a good functional analysis. I say, you know, I think there's four areas that you need to keep in balance. And one of them is work. You know, work is important. It helps you feel productive, helps you feel engaged with life, helps you feel good about yourself. So a good amount of work is important, but not too much work. Relationships are another area that are important. Having healthy relationships, not having kind of anger issues or other things like that, interrupting relationships, meeting with friends, getting out, being with people. So that's another important area. The physical area is a third important area, you know, where you're kind of exercising, moving your body, using it well, feeding it well. So that's an important area. And then finally, your spiritual life, your relationship with God, how you approach these kind of issues about the purpose and meaning of your life. That's another area. So if you can keep all these areas kind of in balance, it's helpful. But I'm going to add an area here for you today, and that area is kind of fun. That's an area that we don't talk about a lot, but, you know, the way we're kind of made, the way we're kind of created, we kind of need to have fun. Just kind of like kids need to have fun, adults also need to have fun, even though that fun is different. So it seems to me, as I look at these areas of your life, it seems to me that you are working really, really hard. And you do a little bit in these other areas. But because you're working so hard, you're not able to devote enough to these other areas, particularly the area called fun. And so I think what you need to do to begin to chip away at this anxiety problem is to actually have some more fun. So I said, back when you were had less work and were doing some fun things, what would you do? What kind of things did you like to do? And she said, well, I like to eat. I said, well, when was the last time you went out to eat to a restaurant? And she said, oh man, it's been years. Years, she said. And I said, wow, that's amazing. Years since you've been out to eat. What's your favorite restaurant? And she said, I think she said something like TGI Fridays. And I said, well, you know, why don't we do that as a homework assignment? You're going to go eat your favorite meal at TGI Fridays. In fact, I want to know exactly what that meal is going to be. What's your favorite meal? And she described her favorite dish at TGI Fridays. And I could tell from her demeanor right away that she was empowered. She was like, yeah, I'm going to do that. I'm going to go and have a meal at TGI Fridays. Now, do meals at TGI Fridays solve anxiety issues and somatic complaints? No, they don't. But it's the approach to the problem that she now had that switched it around entirely. Before, she was focused on, let's get rid of these anxiety symptoms. Now she's focused on, let's bring some balance to my life. And this is one way in which I can do that. And that approach is what then she used to catalyze an entire change process to eventually deal with those anxiety symptoms. And that's what a good functional analysis does for you. It is as much an art as it is a science. So it's something that has to be worked on, and believe you me, just even today, I walked out of a couple of exam rooms shaking my head saying, oh man, I blew that one. So don't be discouraged in your attempts at working on this. Well, that's all for the podcast today. Again, thank you for your attention to these things. Tell your friends about the podcast. Tell them it's really exciting. You can lie to them if you like. Again, next time we should have an interview, if not a couple of interviews, hopefully, to take us through the summer months. This is Dr. Neftali Serrano with the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. Thanks for listening. Check back with us soon. Until then, goodbye. For more information, check out PrimaryCareShrink.com.